Hello and welcome to the Business Standard Morning Show. I'm Nazia Iqbal and here's a look at the stories for the day. India's industrial production in May soared to a 12-month high on the back of a low base. A significant jump in IIP growth indicates economic recovery. But the devil lies in details. So, does a deeper dive into the data support such a positive conclusion? Also, is the recovery sustainable given the raging inflation and adverse global geopolitical conditions? Today's segment answers these questions.
The National Statistical Office came out with a fresh set of macroeconomic data on Tuesday. Industrial production climbed to a 12-month high of around 20% in May year-on-year. But when compared to the same month in 2019, before the coronavirus pandemic hit the country, the rise was just 1.7%. The index of industrial production, or IIP, decelerated in May from 6.5% in April over the corresponding month of 2019. The flat growth might prompt the Reserve Bank of India's Monetary Policy Committee to not go in for an aggressive rate hike in August, in a bid to cool down retail price inflation, which came in at 7.01% in June and above the RBI's mandate of 6% for the sixth month straight. And experts expect inflation to remain elevated through the rest of the year with only a gradual descent. Manufacturing output, which comprises more than three-fourths of the index, fell by almost 1% in May 2022 compared to May 2019. However, the low base effect was so pronounced that manufacturing showed a substantial 21% growth in May year-on-year this time. That is why the government press release on IIP had a note of caution, which said that the growth rates over corresponding period of previous year were to be interpreted considering the unusual circumstances on account of the COVID-19 pandemic since March 2020. Manufacturing might take time to recover since capital goods declined 7% in April and 8% in May compared to the year before COVID-19. A significant pickup in IIP growth would normally indicate ongoing economic recovery. However, a second look, keeping the pre-COVID situation in mind, shows that we are yet to make up for the ground lost during the pandemic years. Furthermore, sluggish demand is best demonstrated by consumer non-durables, whose production fell by 8.7% in May 2022 compared to the same month 3 years ago. Mass consumption remains under stress. The FMCG sector continues to be burdened with weak volumes. This is because inflation has pushed up the prices of goods, thereby afflicting consumption. The situation with consumer non-durables, or FMCG, indicates that India continues to see a K-shaped recovery, where the affluent and those at the bottom of the pyramid recover at vastly different rates. HUL, Dabur India, Asian Paints and Parle products have all seen consumers buying cheaper and smaller packs. Meanwhile, according to Bloomberg, HUL saw its premium portfolio grow at twice the pace as the rest of its portfolio in 2021-22. Marico's premium personal care range also grew in high double digits in FY22. A Nielsen IQ report has also found that the FMCG industry saw a decline in volume in the January-March period. In fact, rural India witnessed a 5.3% fall in volume, the highest consumption slowdown in the last 3 quarters. The report said that a decline in consumption was echoed across all zones and the town classes, but was more prominent in rural markets.
the industrial sector, in particular manufacturing, is just about coming back to the level where we were before COVID really struck. Now, this is significant because this has been on for 2 years now. And the fact that we're growing at, say, less than around 2% compared to COVID means we have just about got to the position from where we need to see more accelerated growth in case we will have to see a much bigger sustainable growth in the IIP number. Now, our own forecast is that the IIP growth for the current financial year on a cumulative basis, of course, for the full year, would be more in the region of around 4.5% to 5%, because this base effect would also keep diminishing. And this growth of around 5% will again roughly take us to a position slightly better than where we were in a pre-pandemic situation, but definitely not towards that 8-9% growth rates which we had witnessed much before, maybe in the early part of the earlier decade. Probably any kind of cooling down of the inflation number will take place only post December. That is, we're talking of next calendar year. There will be a tendency for your real purchasing power to get affected. And this could come in the way of consumption, that is, spending on consumer durable as well as non-durable goods. And what we have seen in the month of May is that while all the other segments statistically showed an upward movement, it was virtually flat for the FMCG goods. And we should remember that FMCG companies are the ones which have started passing on the higher input costs. They have recorded this in most of their quarterly updates. And this is where it's really hurting the consumer.
The economy is yet to fully recover from the scars of the pandemic, and we have just about made up for the losses suffered on its account. And there's a question mark on growth going forward, as much will depend on our ability to tame inflation and overcome geopolitical challenges.
सब अच्छी दिख रही हैं यार, कौन सी खरीदूं?
ये तो वही बात हुई, 4000 शेयर्स लिस्टेड है, कौन सा लूं?
वो तो सबसे आसान है।
तुझे 5 पैसा नहीं पता?
अब तो सबको पता है। 5 पैसा पर है 4000 स्टॉक्स की रिसर्च, टेक्निकल टूल्स और इन्वेस्टमेंट आइडियाज। डाउनलोड 5 पैसा नाउ।
अब तो सबको पता है, इन्वेस्टिंग मेड इजी एंड रिवॉर्डिंग विद 5 पैसा। इन्वेस्टमेंट्स इन सिक्योरिटीज मार्केट आर सब्जेक्ट टू मार्केट रिस्क। रीड ऑल द रिलेटेड डॉक्यूमेंट्स केयरफुली बिफोर इन्वेस्टिंग।
Martin Wolf, chief economics commentator at the Financial Times, also cautioned about what he called emerging threats due to weak investment in the private sector. In an interview given to Business Standard's Asit Ranjan Mishra on the sidelines of Kautilya Economic Conclave, Wolf lists success and failures of the Indian government on economics as well as other fronts. Let's listen in.
The growth record has not been very good, but it's also not been very bad. Growth has clearly not regained the extremely fast growth of 8% a year in the earlier parts of the century. There's no doubt about that. And the country's economy was, of course, terribly hit by COVID. I don't think most people would blame the government for that. There clearly were mistakes made, but I don't think that explains that. That was sort of an act of God, if you like. So don't blame the government for this. But on the other hand, some of the problems they inherited in terms of bad loans, the state of the banking sector and so forth, seems to have been dealt with relatively slowly. There is a perception that the government took some rather whimsical decisions like demonetization. We never really understood what the point of this was, and seems to us probably has, certainly to me, undermined confidence to some degree in the stability of government policy. And then there is, though the measurement of growth is very uncertain, there's a lot of doubt about the quality of the statistics now, but it looks as though some big problems are emerging in terms of relatively weak investment in the private sector in particular, the public sector, there's been very real development of infrastructure, but the public finances look very stretched with very large fiscal deficits. So how do you raise investment durably, which will clearly be needed if growth is to go back up to 8% or more? Where does the money come from? That's really not quite clear. The macroeconomic management has been tolerable. Inflation has been reasonably well managed, but these structural problems are still very clearly there. And then there's concern, I think, about trade policy, and is India seems to have still quite a strong emphasis on self-sufficiency, resistance to specialization in line with comparative advantage. And I think that will probably mean that it will continue not to be fully integrated into the world economy. And that, I think, remains, even in these more difficult times, a prime opportunity for development. So this is the sort of broad economic record. Finally, I think, and the last area I will touch on, which is the attempt to build out some sort of welfare state. I think there's a recognition the government has been really quite successful and quite determined to improve public services for the mass of the people in water, sanitation and things of this kind, employment and so forth, building on its predecessor, the inclusivity of the financial system, the movement to more efficient payment systems, which sort of integrate economics and welfare. This seems to be something of a success. So as I indicated, our perception is a very important country with large potential, with a very strong government, with so far a somewhat mixed record in politics, economics, and broadly welfare, but some clear successes.
Yaar,
mat pooch yaar.
फिर से स्टॉक्स में फंस गया।
तो स्टॉक्स के साथ बॉन्ड्स, इंश्योरेंस, गोल्ड में बैलेंस कर।
इसमें बहुत तामझाम है।
तुझे फाइव पैसा नहीं पता?
अब तो सबको पता है। फाइव पैसा है ऑल इन वन अकाउंट। डाउनलोड फाइव पैसा नाउ।
अब तो सबको पता है। Investing made easy and rewarding with 5paisa. Investments in securities market are subject to market risks. Read all the related documents carefully before investing.
Meanwhile, increase in lending rates, high credit growth, and lower credit costs are expected to help banks report a significant rise in the net interest income and profits in Q1 FY23. Sequentially, however, they may show a drop in the bottom line because of treasury losses due to yields hardening. Watch our next report to get a glimpse of how Q1 results of the banking sector may look like. The April-June quarter earnings season is changing gears with focus shifting from IT to the banking pack. Sector giant HDFC Bank will be the first major bank to report its earnings on Saturday, July 16, while others like IndusInd Bank, ICICI Bank and Axis Bank will release their results next week. According to brokerage estimates, HDFC Bank's net profit may rise between 20 to 30% on a yearly basis, while its net interest income could grow around 16%. The growth in loan book as well as deposits is pegged around 20% year-on-year each, resulting in a flat net interest margin for the quarter. According to the analysts at ICICI Securities, containment of slippages, better recoveries, and improved collections will support HDFC Bank's asset quality trends. However, even as treasury loss will weigh on earnings, lower provisioning relative to Q1 FY22 will lead to robust net profit growth. Overall, Bloomberg's consensus estimates for 12 listed banks peg net profit growth at 47% year-on-year and NII growth at 11.6%. Sequentially, net profit of the sector may shrink 7.8%, while NII could decline 0.3%.
The banking sector will continue to deliver robust numbers driven by sequential improvement in credit growth for the retail and the SME segment. Should see about 15% growth Y on Y. Treasury income could in fact slip. Easing of excess liquidity and a 90 bps increase in repo-linked loans should ensure marginal improvement in the NIMs sequentially. The improvement in asset quality is likely to continue. I think this should be positive for the PSU space. So overall, BFSI space should be performing sector this earnings season.
On Thursday, Q1 FY23 results of ACC, LTI and Tata Elxsi will be on investors' radar. Besides, wholesale inflation print for June, weekly F&O expiry and other global cues will guide the markets.
अब क्या किया?
शेयर्स में ट्रेडिंग।
तुम्हें फाइव पैसा नहीं पता?
ओए, अब तो सबको पता है। फाइव पैसा पर मिलते हैं रिसर्च टूल्स, पोर्टफोलियो एनालिटिक्स और इन्वेस्टमेंट आइडियाज भी। डाउनलोड फाइव पैसा नाउ।
अब तो सबको पता है इन्वेस्टिंग मेड इजी एंड रिपोर्टिंग विद फाइव पैसा। इन्वेस्टमेंट्स इन सिक्योरिटीज मार्केट आर सब्जेक्ट टू मार्केट रिस्क। रीड ऑल द रिलेटेड डॉक्यूमेंट्स केयरफुली बिफोर इन्वेस्टिंग।
Investors indulge in different kinds of fundamental and technical analysis to choose stocks as their investment bets. While fundamental analysis helps investors pick stocks from a long-term perspective, technical analysis could help investors make quick bucks in the short to medium term. Our next report talks about one such technical indicator and how can investors use it to analyze a stock.
Stock or index analysis encompasses numerous methods to determine its price outlook. One of the simple techniques among the technical analysis is moving average. Moving average is the average value of a security over a specified period of time. Usually, when the current price of the security is above its moving average, the trend is considered to be bullish. Similarly, when the price falls below the average, the sentiment is said to be bearish. The most effective moving averages are the 50-day moving average or 50 DMA, 100 DMA and 200 DMA. These are also known as simple moving averages. Combinations of these moving averages often indicate substantial movement in a stock price. Intraday traders consider lower averages such as 9 DMA, 13 DMA, 20 DMA as they help them capture profits on a day-to-day basis while helping them mitigate the risk. From a broader perspective, the major moving average is 200 DMA. Securities trading above or crossing 200 DMA on monthly charts attract attention from long-term investors, resulting in a steady uptrend thereafter. Other than the DMAs or simple moving averages, another moving average technique that is used by traders and investors is exponential moving averages. The difference between the two is that while simple moving averages give equal weightage to all the data points, exponential moving averages apply more weight to recent data. Thus, exponential moving averages facilitate trading when one is attempting to make swing profit as it reflects a change in move rather quickly. A moving average is used by a technical analyst to keep track of price trends for specific securities. An upward trend in the moving average might signify an upswing in the price or momentum of a security, while a downward trend would be seen as a sign of decline. Now that we have clarity of the meaning and significance of moving averages, let's understand how can you use the same while trading or making investment decisions. As can be seen in the chart, the crossover of moving averages is recognized as a trading signal. This reflects the change in sentiment, which inevitably impacts the prices. One of the crossover techniques of moving averages is the golden cross pattern. Here, the smaller moving average crosses over the larger moving average. As can be seen in this chart of Berger Paints, the 50 DMA has made a positive crossover with 200 DMA, which indicates a bullish outlook. Likewise, a death cross gives a negative outlook as and when the 200 DMA falls below the 50 DMA. To conclude, moving averages can assist in filtering out unwanted noise and provide a clear view on the underlying index or stock.
The nation's trusted bank, SBI, the banker to every Indian.
Moving average is one of the oldest and most popular methods to gauge the trend. Well, that's all we have for you today. We will be back with more news and analysis in our next episode. Stay tuned. Thank you for watching.
If you like this video, share it and subscribe to Business Standard. For more news, views and insights, log on to www.business-standard.com. Do also follow us on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Telegram and LinkedIn.